Well, tonight, if you haven't already done so, I encourage you to go ahead and download the PDF copy of our first study. We're going to go through a series of studies on fearless, finding courage in a world ruled by fear. Now, we're going to try doing this Facebook Live here first for our first session. I'm trying to find other software that might help us do this a little bit better. And so if you have any questions or as you're going along and you have any other comments that you want to place there, I'm watching the comment box over here to my right. And so I see Matt has joined us and Gina. It's good to see you, Gina, all the way over in Scottsburg. Amber, great to see you as well, and I hope you and Matt are doing well. Pamela, I'm so excited that you're here as well. And so what we're going to do is we're going to start out here by looking at three major sections in dealing with the topic of fear. Now, what I want you to begin thinking about is that this truly is a time like no other. We turn to the news and we see it on the headlines. We see that the numbers rising of the people that have been attacked by a relentless pursuit of an unseen enemy. And I know that every time we see this news, every time we read the headlines, we get overwhelmed. At least some people do. And so when we see a world that is ruled by panic and fear, then many times it leaves us grasping for answers. And ultimately, the answers are not going to be found just in the encouragement of family and friends, even though that is absolutely critical in this time. The answer is only going to be found in the Lord our God. And so times like this really require us to stand up and face this enemy with great courage, and to face our enemy with faith in order to ultimately prevail for the glory of God and for the salvation of all mankind. And if we choose not to do this in this time, inevitably we understand that we will quiver in fear and fall victim to the effect of an unseen enemy, leaving behind for us generations to come, a wake of destruction from physical to spiritual. And so as we face the times of today, I find great encouragement from the words of Winston Churchill. Churchill faced a time of great uncertainty as well. He faced a time of uncertainty as his country faced a great attack from a great enemy. And he understood that the people had to prevail in order to preserve the country for generations that would follow. And so he gave these encouraging words to the people that were overwhelmed with fear. And this is what he said. The first one was found in May the 13th, 1942, in a speech. And he said, "We have before us an ordeal of the most grievous kind. We have before us many, many long months of struggle and of suffering. You ask, what is our policy? I will say it is to wage war. It is to wage war by sea and land and air with all our might and with all our strength that God can give us. To wage war against a monstrous tyranny, never surpassed in the dark, lamentable catalog of human crime." And then in his speech, The Finest Hour, he said, "To every man there comes that special moment when he will be figuratively tapped on the shoulder and offered the chance to do a special thing unique to him. What a tragedy if that moment finds himself unprepared or unqualified for the world which could have been his finest hour." And I believe today, my friends, I believe my fellow Christians, that this truly is our finest hour, that this is the time in which the Lord our God is asking us to rise up and be the salt and the light like never before. This is to be our finest hour as Christians. And may God give us many, many more fine hours to come. But may we take heart with the words of the Apostle Paul and that of Peter as well. In 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power, and of love, and of self-control. In 1 Peter 3:15, it says, "But in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and with respect." And so today as we gather together, we start looking at the effects of living by fear. What does that really mean? I mean, if we ultimately choose to live a life in which we are ruled by fear, what kind of effect does that really have? I mean, for some people, we may say, well, it's not a big deal if I live a life ruled by fear. I mean, I can just avoid what I need to, and I can just hide from this or hide from that. But the reality is that when we choose to live a life ruled by fear, then fear affects every aspect of our life, from our physical well-being to our emotional well-being to even our walk with the Lord. And remember, God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but He gave us one of power, of love, and self-control. There was a study that was released all the way back in 2010, and I know that study's about a decade old, but I find it interesting because the numbers still remain almost the same, even 10 years later. And the study revealed that in the chronic patient that was seen by physicians, that there was one symptom that stood out among all others. 90% of those chronic patients, their trouble did not start with a cough or with chest pain or with even hyperacidity. In 90% of the cases, the very first symptom was that fear. The point is that fear, as you can see by looking all around us today, by turning on the headlines, by listening on the radio, fear, it affects every aspect of our life in a drastic way. And when we let it overwhelm our life, then it can cause destruction. The great George Mueller, the great man of faith that he was, he once observed that faith ends where worry begins, but worry ends where faith begins. And so as we look to the time in which we are living, we are called to make sure that we make every effort to guard our hearts, our minds, and our spirit from being ruled by fear, eventually even by ruined by fear. And so we want to remember these four very important points when we start to get overwhelmed in a time like this. The very first point that we want to remember here today is that fear, it always twists the truth. There's a quote that I heard some time ago that once said, "When we think like the world and we crave like the world, we will ultimately fear like the world." Because a mind that is not centered on God is a mind that ultimately has great cause to fear. So today, I want to remind you that we serve a God of truth. And fear will do anything and everything possible to twist the truth of God, and to twist His promises. In Psalm 27, verse 1, it's a very comforting passage of Scripture, and it says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And today we take comfort in those words. That is the truth. Point number two that we find today about the effect of fear is that fear ultimately robs you of hope. Fear has a tendency to sneak into your life, and just a little bit at a time, little by little, it begins to erode our hope. Soon we become just overwhelmed with fear. We're consumed with it. And it's like we're living in a dark tunnel, or we're living in the midst of darkness, and it seems like hope is a distant illusion. Something that we dream about, something that we think about, but it doesn't seem like it's something that is tangible. For so many in the time in which we're living today, it seems like fear has robbed them of hope. Haddon Robinson once said, "What worries you masters you." And so we must never let fear master us. We must never let fear consume us with worry, because we understand and we know that we serve a great and a mighty God. And He has given us courage and He has given us strength today to prevail. In Psalm 118, verses 6 through 7, it says, "The Lord is with me." Amen. The Lord is with me. "I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? The Lord is with me. He is my helper." Point number three that we learn here about the effect of fear is that fear robs you of peace. And I wonder how many of you have seen this today. As you turn on the headlines, as you look to people to your left and to your right, even as we look at grocery stores, as we look at convenience stores, that everything is going off the shelves left and right, and they're going quickly. People just seem to have a lack of peace today, and they're consumed with fear. They're overwhelmed with fear. And that peace that they long for, that peace that they so desperately desire, that they want, once again, it seems to be elusive, because fear is starting to control them. It's been said that wisdom teaches us to pray more, and experience teaches us to fear less. And so today I want to remind you of the words of Jesus. In John 14:27, He says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." And so the point is that when we have the peace of the Lord that is in us, that is over us, that is around us and consuming us, then we have nothing to be afraid of. Because the Lord our God, the author of our peace, the originator of our peace, He is with us. And then finally, what we see about the effects of fear is that fear robs us of our courage. Fear has this tendency to slowly erode that little bit of strength, that little bit of courage that we have in our lives. And when we let fear take a little bit more ground, a little bit more of our focus, a little bit more of our attention, then that courage that we once had, that courage to stand up and to stand strong and to stand even against the enemy, it slowly begins to erode. But may not that not be us in this time? In Joshua 1:9, and I know it's a passage that we are all very familiar with, but it's a wonderful passage to be reminded of today. And the Lord says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous." And I think that is a very fitting command for our time. And I understand that it was directly meant for Joshua in his time. But I also believe that it is meant for you and me here today, that the Lord has commanded us to be strong and courageous. He goes on, He says, "Do not be frightened," or "do not be terrified, and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." And so I hope you take great comfort by this today, that even in a world that is overwhelmed by fear, that you and I, that we know that we have nothing to be afraid of, that we can be strong and courageous because the Lord our God is with us wherever we go. And to that, we can all say amen. Now that we kind of know the effects of what it looks like to have a life that is ultimately ruled by fear. The question ultimately is, so what do we do about that? If you don't want to live a life in which you are ruled and ultimately ruined by fear, then what is the real solution? Well, the solution actually is found in living your life by faith. So here it is that we replace our fear with that of faith. And so as we begin looking at the second section that you have there in your outline, then we are reminded that it's been observed throughout history that those that have accomplished the most for the glory of God, even in the face of opposition, even in the face of fear, those who have accomplished the most for the glory of God are those who thought the most of that which lay beyond this life. Those that thought the most of God, of His Word, and our ultimate eternal reward. And so it's been said, faith compels us to push forward, because no matter what lies ahead of us, God is already there. And so the big question is, how? How can I really start living by faith, starting today, in the midst of a culture that is overwhelmed by fear? How do I live radically different? Well, first and foremost, you choose to set your sight on the Lord. You begin fixing your heart, your mind, your focus. Even in the midst of troubling times, you begin to focus everything you have and everything you are upon the Lord. In Colossians 3, 1 through 4, it says, "If then you've been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth." Right now, this is so critical that we would set our minds on the things that are above, on the Lord's promises that He has for you and me, that we would set our minds on God and the great things that He has for us to accomplish. So set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And so when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. And so set your sight on the Lord. That's the very first way that you can begin living your life by faith in the midst of a time in which the world is ruled by fear. The second part of this, for all of us that are followers of Christ, then we choose to trust the Lord. That we really do trust Him. Because ultimately, even what you and I are experiencing here today in this time, it is all out of our control. It is all out of our hands. And so we need to trust the Lord. Now, yes, we need to be wise. There's no doubt about that. We need to be wise in how we operate day by day. We need to be wise even by following basic health standards. We need to be wise. But in all things, we need to trust the Lord. In Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, that wonderful passage of Scripture, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding." Man, how many times is that so difficult for us to ultimately trust in the Lord with all of our heart and not lean on our own understanding? So many times our understanding, our own intellect, our own observations, our own will, our own desires are what gets us into trouble. And when we begin relying upon our own understanding and our own intellect, we will ultimately see that fear will grow in our life. It won't fade, but it will grow. And so trust in the Lord with all your heart. And in all of your ways, whether it's the littlest thing or the biggest thing, in all your ways acknowledge Him. And He will make your paths straight. The third part in that outline that you want to remember here about living by faith in the midst of troubling times is to fear the Lord more than the world. In Proverbs 1:7, it says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." I've seen it for many years now, and I'm sure that you have all seen it as well, that we have a culture that lives more by the fear of man than the fear of being accepted by man, the fear of being rejected by man, than they actually fear the Lord. And so here today, we see a culture that doesn't live by wisdom and knowledge. They live by the philosophies of man and the theologies of man, which ultimately only leads them to destruction. And so we're called to fear the Lord today. Even in the midst of troubling times, we have so many things that threaten our peace and threaten our health, so many things that could ultimately lead us to be afraid. The only thing we really need to be afraid of is the Lord. And that means to stand back in awe and respect of His reverence. And that also means that we would stand back in awe of His great power. And so to fear the Lord means to respect Him and even to stand back in awe of Him. And that's the third part of it. Finally, what we see here, to live our life by faith and not ruled by fear as followers of Christ, is that ultimately, you and I, we need to love the Lord with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and even love our neighbor as ourselves. In Matthew 22:37, the great teacher of the people of the day, they once asked Jesus which was the greatest commandment. And Jesus said to him and said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind." The greatest commandment hasn't changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament. From the beginning of time to the end of time, that great commandment will always be the same. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. So what does it really mean to live by faith? Well, set your sight on the Lord, trust the Lord, fear the Lord, and love the Lord. And that's the beginning steps. But whatever you do, be wise. Be wise in the time you're living. Be wise and follow those standards that have been given to you for basic health and basic well-being. But in all things, never, never lose sight of trusting the Lord. Trusting the Lord here and now, and trusting the Lord forevermore. The final section that we look at here in our outline is something that I hope encourages you. I know that this is an overwhelming time, and I know that this is a time that we all have to be cautious, that we have to be careful, and this is a time that we probably have so many questions, more questions that are unanswered than questions that are answered. And sometimes we even have those questions and we cry out to the Lord, why? And sometimes we won't get those answers until we finally are home forevermore with the Lord. In Deuteronomy 29:29, the Lord reminds us that there are some secret things that only belong to the Lord. So I wish I could tell you exactly why we're going through a time such as this. What I do know is that we live in a fallen world, and we live in a world that is affected by death and disease and destruction. But even in the midst of a world like this, you and I, we can shine. We can shine right where we're at. We can encourage friends and family members. We can encourage neighbors, whether it's through a phone call, a text, online, whatever it may be. But ultimately, I hope that you are encouraged in this time and that you ultimately begin living each day a little bit more by faith and a little bit less by fear. And so I want you to be reminded of these promises of God today. Sometimes the Lord ultimately calms the storm, but sometimes He lets the storm rage and He calms His children. And I believe that's where you and I are at today. The storm rages on all around us, but you and I, we are being calmed by the Lord by looking and remembering and keeping true to His promises. What's the first promise that we want to remember here today? Is that God gives us peace in times of trouble. Remember that passage we read earlier, John 14:27? It says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. So let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." And so today, we have been given the peace through Jesus Christ that the world could never understand, and that the world could never offer us. It's a peace that can only be found through Christ. I hope today you come to know that peace better than ever before. The second promise that we're given in the Word of God is that God gives us courage to face the enemy, even an unseen enemy. Remember Joshua 1:9, we read it earlier, where the Lord says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous, and do not be frightened, and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." And my hope is that you would remember here today that God is with you, even in the midst of an overwhelming and a fearful time. Please be strong and be courageous this very day. And then we want to remember this promise of God, that God delivers us from fear. The fear that threatens to overwhelm us and consume us, God delivers us from that fear. In Psalm 34, verse 4, he says, "I sought the Lord, and he answered me." Please pay careful attention to that. May that be your prayer as you go to bed tonight. May it be the prayer for your family, your friends, your neighbors, your church, your community. "I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears." What a powerful prayer to pray. What a promise to call upon the Lord our God. May that be your prayer this very night. The next promise is that God is the light and the salvation that conquers our dark times of fear. In Psalm 27, verse 1, it says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. So why should I be afraid? The Lord is my fortress, protected me from danger. So why should I tremble?" May you find your refuge today in the Lord your God. May you find the light that you so desperately long for in this dark time in the Lord your God. May you always remember that the salvation that you long for, a salvation not just for this moment, not just for this time, the salvation that you long for all eternity, is only found through Jesus Christ. And so never forget that. And may you share that good news in this time of great fear. Then we look at the next promise, and that is that God strengthens and sustains you. We're going to preach a little bit more on this starting this Sunday as we begin a new series called Fear Not. And here's what it starts out with. It says, "Fear not, for I am with you." Now these are the very words of the Lord, mind you. "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." That is an amazing promise from God. And so call upon him in that way this day. And then finally, I want to remind you that God alone saves. In Isaiah 43, verse 11, the Lord reminds us, "I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior." And so today, as we gather together, as we live in a time of such great uncertainty, as we live in a time overwhelmed by fear and consumed with anxiety, then we have some amazing promises that are only found in the Lord our God. And I hope today that you would begin that first step in living this day and the days ahead with a little bit more faith and less fear. Now, be wise, use discernment, follow all those health and safety codes that will help you be safe in these days. But in all things, trust the Lord more and more than ever before. This is our time to shine. This is our greatest hour as Christians. Let us shine brightly for the Lord our God. I'm going to ask you to go ahead, if you would, and join me as we close with a word of prayer. And so if you would, just join me for a moment. And let's pray that Psalm 34, verse 4, this night. For our family, for our friends, for our churches, and our community, for our country. Here it is. Let's pray. Dear Father God, we come to you tonight, and we are overwhelmed by so many things that are going on all around us. Things that are out of our control. We are being assaulted by an unseen enemy. And so this night, Lord, we come to you. We seek you like we've never sought you before. In the history of our life, we seek you greater and more passionately and with more zeal than before. And Father God, we pray that you would answer us. We pray that you would deliver us. That you would deliver us from this time. That you would deliver us from our fears. That you would give us wisdom and discernment. And that, yes, that you would help us live with great respect for one another, but ultimately great respect for you. And Father God, we pray. We pray that you would replace our fear with peace and hope, and that you would replace our fear with just a little bit more faith than we had before. May this be our finest hour, Father God. May we not let you down. May we shine brightly. May we honor you forever and always. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, Amen.